Nasrat Muhammad Nasri.
Saya ada
How many of you in the group?
29.
29.
Ya.
Okay. So now we have 28. Okay, seorang lagi. Thank you. Alright, assalamualaikum and good evening. I think we can start now. Okay, everybody's here already, I think. 30, okay, 30, alright. Okay, can you see my slide? Anyone?
Boleh ada.
Okay, alright.
Yes,
Boleh.
Alright, thank you. Okay, so before we start, I'm not sure everybody in this group know me or not. Okay, but just a brief. A little bit of myself lah. As you can see that my name is Muhammad Reza Aisyah. Okay, so starting from this week, I will take over the subject from Dr. Rostam. Okay, until week 9. So you have with me for 4 weeks. Okay, so after that, Dr. Shazarina will take over until end of semesters lah. Okay. So before we start with the lecture, I think I hope you have downloaded the notes which I uploaded in new feature, so you can refer to the notes lah. Okay, before we start with the lecture, with our first lecture, okay, let me show you the lecture schedule for my part for the next 4 weeks. Okay, what you're going to go through. Okay, starting from this week, which is week 6, we are going to cover the topic of safety and health management. Okay, next week in week 7, we are going to move on to the next topic, which is quality management. And then we are going to have a semester break for 1 week. And after that, in week 8, we will continue with our last topic for my part, okay, which is on waste management. So in all, I have 3 topics to cover lah. Okay, so all on my class, for the time being, I will conduct using Google Meet lah. If any changes, I will let you know later on lah. Okay. And in week 9, which is my last week with you all before Dr. Shazarina take over, okay, I will have we will have a briefing on your final assessment. Okay, so as you all know, we are going to have a online final exam. So I'm going to brief you what you're going to do to cover your final exam, okay, or your final assessment for my part. Okay, so again, I will conduct the briefing using Google Meet as well. Okay, so that's what we are going to go through for the next 4 weeks lah. Okay, until week 9. Okay, 5 weeks lah, including semester break. Alright, so today we are going to start with our first lecture on safety and health or health and safety management. Okay, so this is the outline for today's lecture. Okay, we will have, firstly, we will have an introduction. We are going to have an overview on the common perception of construction industry, particularly in Malaysia, and then we are going to have a look on some of the legislation related to safety and health in our country, especially introduced or developed by DOSH. Okay, and we are going to have a look one of the approaches that we could use in our construction project in managing the safety and health, which known as HIREC, hazard identification, risk assessment and risk control. And then we are going to see or we are going to discuss some of the guidelines that we can refer to in order to implement safety and health management system in our construction project or even in our construction industry, okay, which is known as OSAS and also Malaysian Standard 1722. And then finally, on our last part, for today's lecture, we are going to go through some of the government initiatives and which emphasizing on the element of safety and health in our country lah. Okay, some of them. Okay, kita kan we are going to go through a little bit on some of the government initiative. Okay, so that's what we are going to go through today. Alright, before we go into detail about safety and health, okay, so we will have an overview of the common perception of construction industry, okay, especially in developing countries like Malaysia lah. Okay, so construction industry, as I mentioned earlier, in developing countries like Malaysia, ada lagi nak join ke? Okay, construction industry, particularly in developing countries like Malaysia, always being referred or always or very synonym with the 3D images, or some people can refer to as 4D images. Okay, so 3D or D, what represent those D? Okay, so D represent dirty, dangerous, difficult. Or even if you want, you can include another D, which make it 4D, bukan 4D nombor dua, death, okay, mati, die, alright. So that's a common perception of construction industry, particularly in developing countries like Malaysia. Okay, we cannot run from these 3D images or 4D images, okay, because most of the construction project in developing countries still rely on labor intensive method, which is known as a conventional or traditional method of construction. Okay, selagi kita pakai traditional method of construction or conventional method of construction, selagi itulah kita tak boleh lari daripada these images, 3D images, ADT dan very difficult or even that. Alright, beside that, there is another perception that all work sites are the same and injuries and death could happen anytime and part of the construction process. Okay, so there is a perception on that element. Okay, they think that all the work site, all the construction project are the same, and accident is already part of the construction process. Okay, so actually they are not the same. Okay, they are not the same. Even the working style is not similar among the site. Okay, between project, among the projects, among the site is totally different. Project A, the working environment, it will be totally different compared to project B. Okay, it is also not similar in terms of within the site itself. Okay, the activities that being carried out within the project, within the site itself, could change every single day. Okay, we are going to go through different activities for our project. So different activities will face different risks or categories of safety and health. Okay, so it's not the same. Okay, that's the perception that we are trying to change. Okay, when we are talking about construction industry, particularly in developing countries like Malaysia. Alright, here I can show you some of the scary facts about safety and health aspect of construction industry. Okay, for example, like each day, an average of 5,000 people globally die as a result of work-related accidents or disease. Okay, every year workers suffer from 270 million occupational accidents and some 160 million non-fatal disease. Okay, hazardous substances in industry kill about more than 400,000 workers annually. Okay, so that's how scary the fact about safety and health aspect. Okay, not only in construction industry, on other industries as well. So it is a real concern lah, in order to emphasize on the element of safety and health in the construction project. Okay, later on we are going to see more on why we need to emphasize on or prioritize on the aspect of safety and health. Alright, next we will have an overview of safety and health management in a global aspect. Okay. So worldwide, construction is one of the most hazardous industries due to its unique nature, as the activities are performed and outdoor under conditions not conducive for safety and health. Okay, as you all know, most of you, I think, would work in the construction industry, construction environment. Okay, you are aware that when you work in the construction project or construction industry, most of the activities are being carried out outside or outdoor. Okay, so most of the activities being carried out on site. Okay, the construction activities, concreting, plastering, and etc. So you are going to be exposed to danger when you work outdoor. Okay, especially when we are talking about high-rise project and so on. So accident can happen at any time. So workers at the construction site have to face constant changes in the nature of work, the location of work, work with new workers. Okay, most of the people tend to relate construction industry to high-risk working environment as compared to the others. Okay, so we are in the category of high-risk working environment. Okay, that's the fact that we cannot deny or run from. Okay. So the reputation of the construction industry relies on the expertise of implementation and managing safety while meeting the consumer's requirements lah. So therefore, it is very important to prioritize the safety and health aspect of the construction industry. Okay, so because we are working in the high-risk working environment, so we cannot ignore or put aside the element of safety and health in the construction industry. Okay, we need to prioritize the aspect. Right, next, we are going to have a look on these two statements, okay, derived from previous studies done by previous researchers. Okay. The first statement stated that the construction industry is an important sector of any national economy, especially regarding its employment potential. By accidents, incidents, injuries and fatalities continue to occur and abated on construction sites around the world at consistently high rates. Okay, this is being mentioned by Haynes 1997. Okay, so as you all know, construction industry is one of the important sector in our economy itself, in Malaysian economy. Okay, we can be categorized as an economic prime mover. Okay, construction industry in Malaysia, gerak utama ekonomi kita. Alright, so because one of the good thing about construction industry because of the employment potential lah. Okay, so job opportunities yang banyak dan sebagainya. But accident can happen. Okay, later on when I show you the statistic, you will realize that how many fatality rates has been occur from construction industry in Malaysia. Okay, so the second statement stated by Bings and Friends okay, in 2005, state that the construction industry tends to have a low awareness of the long-term benefit of safety practices, while the tendering process often gives little attention to safety, resulting in cost and corner cutting. Okay, so these two statements show that safety and health aspect of construction industry has been ignored. Okay, along the construction project, okay, has been ignored and has became a secondary factor. Okay, the main issue or the main factor or the main priority has been given towards cost. Okay, most of the stakeholders involved in construction project more concerned about the cost. The other aspect, including safety and health, has become a secondary factor. Okay, bukan tak penting. Okay, it's not on the top list lah. Okay, the main concern is about the cost. Alright, so that's the issue about safety and health. Not only in our country lah, okay, other country also face the same scenarios. Alright, here some of the examples of accident related to construction industry around the world. Okay, so as you can see here occur in July 1988, okay, we killed 165 explosion in oil and gas in a project, Piper Alpha, I'm not sure, in US I think. Alright, show kat mana. Alright, this one, the second picture happened in Mexico, okay, which killed 100 people and injured 1,000. It happened in 1984 lah. Alright, so here some of the ada lagi nak join ke? Okay, ni here some of the example of accident related to construction industry lah globally. Okay, the next we are going to move on the scenario in Malaysia. okay, in terms of safety and health lah. Tadi kita tengok on the global aspect of safety and health. So now we focusing on the Malaysian context. Okay. Alright, the Malaysian construction industry has been plagued by a poor safety record to the due to a confluence of factors. Okay, dia punya influencing factors. Okay, include itinerant labor force. Okay, because as you all know, when you work in the construction project, the mobility, the workforce, the workers will keep moving around the site. Okay, they are mobile. Okay, from one place to one place around the site. Okay, so that also will influence to a poor safety record in our construction industry in Malaysia. Okay, this continuity of construction project, our project not be managed properly, not be managed efficiently. Okay, so that's why could influence accident to happen in our construction project, and also pressure to complete work on time. Okay, this is one of the contribution factors to a poor safety record as well. Okay, so as a contractor, as a team members of the project, we are always pressurized to complete the work on time. Okay, however, as you can see, we still find it difficult to complete our project on time lah. Okay, I'm not sure. Okay, maybe out of 10 project in Malaysia, maybe one yang boleh siap on time. Maybe, I'm not sure lah. Okay. Okay, as of October 2020, okay, last month, the number of fatalities rate on construction construction site was the highest. Okay, the reported fatalities were 54. Ini yang being reported to DOSH. Okay, yang tak report kita tak tahu. Okay, tapi yang being reported under construction industry 54 the fatality rate, which is the highest so far October 2020. Okay, nanti saya akan tunjuk more detail about it. Okay, but and previously from in 2014, the fatality rate was 7.26 per 100 workers. Okay, ini Malaysia punya data, 7.26 per 100 workers. Okay, seramai 100,000 pekerja, maksudnya 7 orang tu akan mati. Okay, itulah dia punya teori, fatality rate. Okay, in 2005, increased to 10.74, almost 11. Okay, 2016, increased to 12.78, almost 13. And in 2017, increased to 14.94, almost 15. Okay, out of 100,000 workers yang bekerja dalam construction industry, 15 orang akan mati. Itulah dia punya konteks. Okay, idea apa ni, rate, apa ni, nisbah adalah. Okay. Okay, as compared to industrialized nations such as Japan, Canada and Australia, which reported an average of 3 fatality rates. Okay, jauh dia punya rate dia dengan kita. Okay. Kita, kalau kita ambil yang the latest 2017 ni almost 15, dia negara Japan, Canada and Australia ni only 3 saja. Okay, 5 kali ganda. Okay, that's how worse our construction, our safety and health aspect in our construction project. Okay, here some of the statistics of construction accident, okay, which I derived from DOSH website. Okay, this one is last year, 2019. Okay, ni tahun lepas punya. Okay, this is the sector that being included, okay, under the DOSH. Okay, as you can see, construction, the total accident reported to DOSH is was 326. Okay, not the highest. Okay, paling banyak accident is manufacturing punya industry, almost 5,000 cases. But the main concern is the death or fatality rate, as you can see here. Okay, second last column. Okay, the highest was construction sector. Okay, which 84 deaths reported for last year. Okay, accident ni 300 je tapi yang mati 84. Okay, compared to manufacturing, accident ni almost 5,000, yang mati 73 sahaja. Okay, kita the highest for last year. For this year, as of October 2020, okay, even though, as you can see, as you are aware, our construction industry for the year 2020 is quite slow. Okay, moving agak perlahan. Okay, impact daripada COVID dan sebagainya. Tapi still, kita the highest, 54. Tapi kali ni sama dengan manufacturing lah. Manufacturing pun 54 as of October 2020. Tapi accident kita hanya 199 sahaja. Tapi yang menyebabkan kematian 54. Okay, tapi kita ada 2 bulan lagi nak sampai end of year 2020. So maybe the numbers is increasing lah. Okay, hopefully not the highest lah anymore. Okay, so that's how worse the situation of construction industry in terms of safety and health in our country lah, based on this data. Okay. Okay, here some of the accidents related to construction industry have occurred in our country. Okay, and this one most of them happen in this year. Ada yang tahun lepas, ada yang 3 tahun lepas. Yang ni yang I think the recently lah. Okay, September 19, okay, 19 September 2020 yang jatuh kat highway ni. Okay, nasib baik tak mati. Case ni pun has, I think has been solved. The victim has been paid, I think if not mistaken, almost 200K kot. Contractor being liable. Okay, the scenario in Malaysia when accident happen, the most responsible party is the contractor. Okay, so however our human resource, okay, Kementerian Sumber, Ministry of Human Resource, Kementerian Sumber Manusia is trying to revise the act related to accident in the context of construction industry. Okay, they want to make sure that everybody involved in that particular project will be liable to any accidents. Not only contractor, designers, developers or client also will be responsible. Okay, they are trying to revise. Okay, ini boleh buka tadi. Tengok one of this. Okay, ini previous government ni lah sebelum kita tukar government ni sebenarnya. Alright, this is the initiative by previous Minister of Human Resource, AM Kula Segara ni. Okay, they want to revise the act related to the rules related to safety and health. Okay, so they want to reduce the burden on contractor. Okay, they want to make sure that designers or developer also will be liable. Okay, for worker safety. Okay, I'm not sure the progress, whether it is being continued by current government or not. But with the current situation, I think current government is more focusing on solving the issues of COVID and also our economy lah. I'm not sure the progress lah, okay. Even current punya human resource minister pun saya tak tahu siapa. Okay. Alright, so from there, we can see that it is important to ensure that we focus on safety and health aspect and develop a strategic and effective safety and health management system in our organization or even in our construction project. Okay, so to ensure this, we need a proper legislation. Okay, legislation that we could look for to minimize the impact of safety and health in our construction project. Okay, so we have that because we have DOSH, Department of Occupational Safety and Health. Okay, so under the DOSH, there are a few acts that could be useful to construction industry. Even though we don't have any acts that specifically focus on construction industry. Okay, acts developed by DOSH is more general. Okay, they can be used in any industries. Okay, so that's act. Okay, what they have is some guidelines, regulation. That one have under the DOSH, we have guidelines specific on construction industry. Okay, under acts kita tak ada. Kita tak ada acts yang specific on construction industry. Kita ada general acts that could be used for every industries. When it comes to guideline, kita ada guideline yang specific on construction industry. Nanti kita akan tengok. Okay, some of the acts that are useful in terms of occupational safety and health. Okay, for example like Factories and Machinery Act 139, which is being introduced in 1967 and being revised in 1974 and then being amended in 2006. Okay, and we also have OSHA. Okay, this is one of the most popular acts related to safety and health. Okay, OSHA 1994. This one that being planning to revise by by the previous government, okay, by the previous Minister of Human Resource, okay, but I'm not sure the progress lah, okay. Alright, as I mentioned earlier, these ads are regulated by DOSH, okay. Even you can go to website DOSH, you can have a look on in detail on this element lah. Okay, kita tengok sekejap. Jen. Okay, so this is website DOSH. Okay, the legislation, the acts, itulah tadi, factory tadi, OSHA tadi, regulation, order, cooperative, code of practice, guideline. Okay, so under guideline ni lah yang ada, as I mentioned, ada specifically on building, construction and engineering work. Okay, so yang tadi acts tadi lebih general. Okay, tapi under guidelines, ada focus on each industry lah. Okay, so under this website lah, you can see the statistic. Okay, occupational accident statistic. Okay, for the past 5 years lah. Okay, 6 years lah including this year. Okay. Okay, we have a look on a little bit detail on OSHA. Okay, Occupational Safety and Health Act, okay, 1994. Okay, so the main principle that has been taken as a foundation in drafting of this act include these three principles. Okay, the first one is self-regulation. Okay, so basically to handle issue related to occupational safety and health, employers must develop a good and orderly management system. It's starting with formation and consequently employer have to make the proper arrangement to be carried out. Okay, so in terms of safety and health management system, as an employer, you need to have your own team to create or to develop or to formulate your own safety and health management in your construction projects. Okay, so you have to develop your own safety and health management system. You have to create your own policy, and then you have to find ways on how you need to make sure that those policies will be carried out and will be followed by your employees. Okay, so another principles of OSHA is consultation or tripartite. Okay, anything happen, they encourage consultation, okay, between among employers, employees and the government, okay, to settle arising issues or problems related to occupational safety and health at the workplace. And the last principles is cooperation. Okay, where employers and employees must cooperate to take care, nurture and to increase the quality of occupational safety and health at the workplace. Okay, they encourage two-way communication between employers and employees on how they can improve or enhance their safety and health management in their organization or in their construction project. Alright, so basically there are six objectives of OSHA, okay, which include to promote and secure the safety and health of people at work, okay, to protect people, okay, to assist in securing safe and hygiene work environment, to reduce, eliminate and control the hazards, to foster cooperation, consultation between employees and employees, employer and employees, okay, to promote education and community awareness. Okay, that's among the objective of OSHA. Okay, how the OSHA works, okay. So, firstly, we need to set a safety and health of policy. So, this is the main responsibility of the employers. Okay, they need to create or develop their own policies regarding safety and health. Okay, and then they need to have their own management organization or management team that will be responsible to focus on safety and health. And then they need to appoint safety committees officer, okay, in their organization or even their construction project. Okay, as you I think you are aware that every construction project in Malaysia should have compulsory to have a safety officer in their construction project. Okay, maybe they need to appoint safety audit and statistical analysis. Okay, so for auditing purposes. Okay, and then they need to report any accident, even near miss accident. Okay, even if the workers or employees have a disease, okay, they have to report so that they can investigate what are the causes to that accident, what are the causes to the disease, and so on. and then they need to have a regular training, okay, to upgrade their workers awareness and skills towards safety and health aspect. Okay. Alright. As I mentioned before, all the acts related to safety and health, including OSHA, reflect the importance of relationship and also responsibility of the employers and also employees. Okay, that's the main ingredient of this act. Okay. So we want direct relationship between employers and employees in emphasizing the element of safety and health. Okay. As one of the main principles of OSHA is about consultation, okay, between employers and employees. So what is the purpose of consultation? Okay, consultation will promote open communication, okay, cooperation, assess a wide range of knowledge, experience held by employees and employers. Okay, perhaps employees or workers more realize or more exposed to the working environment, so they have more knowledge on how danger their working environment, so they can let the employees know about their conditions and so on. Okay, speedy resolution of issues and dispute. If you have a proper consultation between employers and employees, okay, active and informed participation by employees in the management workplace, safety and health, okay, and share ownership of safety and health goals. Okay, so if you have a direct relationship between employers and employees, okay, the responsibility, the ownership of the goal or the policy will be more clear lah. Okay. Okay. As I mentioned just now, the main ingredient of OSHA is about the duties or the relationship between employers and employees. Okay. So here we can see the main duties of employers towards the employees. Okay. So so what are the duties employers? Okay. To make sure that their employees or workers are more safer, okay, when they work in the organization or even in the construction project. Okay, of course, some of the duties of employer is the safe plan and system of work. So they need to make sure the plan, the equipment, the machinery that they use in their construction project is safe to use, okay, work properly, okay, safe use storage and handling of plan and substances, okay, information, instruction and training and supervision. Okay, so they need to inform any related information, any related information about safety and health, clear instruction, provide relevant training to their workers. Okay, safely at work. Okay, this is the duty of employer. Safe access and egress. Okay, written general OSH policy. Okay, so you need to have a written policy on your organization or even your construction project. Okay, not to charge employees for things done or provided. Okay. Employer to report accidents, dangerous occurrence, occupational poisonings or disease to DOSH. Okay, so this is the duties or responsibilities of employees. Okay, so they need to report anything to DOSH. Okay, jangan hide anything lah. Okay, even I know it happened, especially in construction project. Okay, not all accidents occur in construction project being reported to DOSH. Okay, as an employer, you're not only responsible to the employees. Okay, you also being responsible to the safety of the non-employees or persons surrounding your in our case surrounding your construction site. Okay, so ensure he or others are not exposed to OSH risk and give others OSH information as prescribed. Okay, so the simple example I can give you in terms of duties of employers to other person, okay, to non-employees lah, okay, people surrounding the construction site is by using signage, proper signage lah, okay. So that's one of the duties of employers towards non-employees, okay, people surrounding your construction site. Okay, so you need to have a proper signage so that people surrounding your concession site aware about what is happening on your concession site or concession project. Alright, that's the duties of employees. Okay, how about the duties of employees? Okay, guys. Cepat, ayo tengok kelas ini. Ini mana? Sorry, ada interruption. Alright, that's the duties of the employees. So how about the duties of the employees? Okay, so jangan ingat employee ni tak ada duty. Okay, so tak ada responsibility. Okay, so the duties of the employees include reasonable care of self and others. Okay, cooperate to help others discharge their duties. Use protective equipment and clothing provided, which is PPE lah. Okay, comply with instruction or measures made in accordance with OSH legislation. Not to interfere or misuse things done in accordance with OSH legislation. Okay, so the easiest way of employees to be responsible in terms of safety and health in the construction process is to wear PPE lah, any equivalent or any relevant PPE that they need to wear during when they are doing their work in the construction site lah. Okay. Alright, so basically we have discussed some of the component that has been included in OSHA in general. Okay, so by having those kind of acts, it show that our government is very serious in tackling the issues related to safety and health, okay, particularly in the construction industry. So next, before we discuss further about how we can develop a proper and efficient safety and health management system in our construction project, so let's have a look on one of the approaches that we can adopt in our construction industry or in our construction project, which is known as HIRAD, okay? Hazard Identification, Risk Assessment and Risk Control. So when we talk about safety and health issue, we can relate to the level of risk of our construction project. Okay, so bila kita nak identify safety and health, we cannot run from the idea of identifying the risk. Okay, so it quite related between these two aspects, safety and health and also risk. So therefore, it's a good practice to integrate risk management to minimize the risk of accident to occur in our construction industry. Okay, so it is advisable if you could implement HIRAD in your construction project before you start your construction project. Right, before we go into detail about HIRAD, there are two major categories of hazard in construction sites. Okay, namely the risk of physical injury or physical injury hazard. Okay, so this one is normally associated with process of work or equipment use, such as scaffolding, okay, power access equipment, okay, some sort of electrical equipment, apa lagi, ladder, tangga, alright, roof work, excavation work, plant and machinery works, okay, ni yang expose us to the physical injury, alright, scaffolding, maybe dengan naik jatuh ke dan sebagainya, okay, that's the first category of hazard, okay. The second category of hazard is the risk of ill health or health hazard. This may be grouped under the category of chemical, biological or physical hazard. Okay, so this category of hazard can only be notified after a long period. Okay, so it shall cause sickness or even death after a certain period of time. Okay, impact dia lama. Okay, kesan dia lama. Maybe kita play around with the chemical and so on. Okay, compared to risk of physical injury, tadi the first one, the impact dia lebih cepat. Okay, jatuh patah terus. Tapi kalau ill health or health hazard dia, impact dia in the long run. Okay, so that's the categories of hazard could happen on construction site. Okay, so here's some of the common hazardous operation at construction site. As I mentioned earlier, scaffold and working in height, falling on deck, machinery tools and equipment, etc. Okay. Alright, high rise is a useful risk management tool. Okay, that could be used in our construction project. Okay, that the main elements that include that has been included in high rise, begin with high rise hazard identification. Okay, so we are going to identify what hazard that we are going to face when we carry out our construction project. Any high rise work, as well as okay, followed by risk assessment, how maybe we can level up the risk of our works. Okay, is it low risk, medium risk, or high risk? Okay, then we can control. Okay, maybe we can use PPE as one of the option. Okay, maybe we can change our construction method to minimize the weight and the risk. Okay, and then maybe we need some budget for implementation of control, and then we can see the effectiveness of the control, and then we need to document it all the process that we have carried out. So basically the purpose of high-rise are as follows. Okay, to identify all the factors that may cause harm. Okay, to consider what the chances of that harm actually befalling anyone in the circumstances. Okay, to enable employers to plan, introduce and monitor preventive measures. That's some of the purpose of high-rise. Okay, let's get, we have a look on the process of high-rise involved. Okay. So here is the diagram show the process of high-rise that we need to carry out. Firstly, we need to classify work activities. Okay, so we need to detail up what are the activities that we are going to carry out in our construction project. Okay, maybe from start to finish. Okay, so from there, we can identify which activities have a high level of risk. Okay, and then the next process we need to consult. Okay, so when we already classified the activities, then we can consult with the among the stakeholders, team members involved with the employers and employees. Okay, from there we can identify, we can rank which activities has a high level of risk, and so on. Okay. And then we can identify the hazard. Okay, so again, as I mentioned earlier, okay, we can detail up which activities will cause which hazard. Okay, just now I mentioned we have two categories of hazard. Okay, physical injury atau ill health tadi. Okay, yang menyebabkan yang accident yang boleh menyebabkan kita injury on the spot or in the long run, so kita boleh identify. And then we can assess the risk. Okay, we can identify the level of risk again, how to control it. Okay, we can prepare risk control action plan. Okay, okay, for example, like as I mentioned earlier, we can ask the workers to comply with PPE. Okay, even though actually for information, using PPE is the last option to control risk. Okay, nak control risk, nak control accident, PPE is the last option. Okay, so kita kena consider the option first. Maybe we substitute the materials, okay, we change the method that is going to be used in that activities. Okay, boleh pilih activities yang less danger dan sebagainya lah. Okay, so after that we can implement the high-rise lah. Okay, so that's how we develop high-rise in our construction project. So however it is, this high-rise should be developed before the project start. Okay, so before the project start, we need to develop this high-rise. Okay, so that's one of the way we can control, minimize the occurrence of accident to occur in our construction project. Alright, so far we have discussed about the acts related to safety and health. Okay, that's now we touched a little bit on OSHA, and then we just now touched a little bit on how we can carry out a risk management approach using HIREC. So next, we need some sort of code of practice or guideline in developing an effective safety and health management system. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, OSHA is just an act, okay, not focusing 100% on construction industry. Okay, OSHA is an act, and then occupational safety and health management system is some of what we call it as a code of practice that we can refer to in order to develop our safety and health management system in our construction project. Okay, from OSHA, we refer to this occupational safety and health management system to get a better understanding on how we can implement the app. Okay, so that's how it works. So the objective of occupational safety health management system is to create a safe working environment. Okay, of course, without ignoring the organization rules. Okay, and then we want to enable an organization to establish a prevention system to safeguard the working environment. Okay, so kita nak create a safe working environment lah, the main objective of occupational safety and health management system. Okay, some of the occupational safety and health management system standard that we have and we can refer to, including OSAS, occupational health and safety. Saya tak ingat nama penuh, nanti kita tengok. Oh ni ada, occupational health and safety management system, OSAS. Okay. It's a guideline. Okay, there are a few guidelines as to 18001 and 18002, and we also have our own Malaysian standard. Okay, OSAS ni is more on international standard. Okay, so while Malaysian standard is domestic standard lah, we create our own Malaysian standard regarding occupational safety, health and safety, okay, safety and health management system. Okay, so firstly kita tengok before we go into detail about the international standard of occupational safety and health management system in terms of OSAS. Okay, the benefits of having a good occupational safety and health management system in our organization or in our organization is that we can eliminate or at least minimize the risk to our employees. They show evidence of systematic arrangement, so means that we can show that we are concerned about safety aspect in our construction project or even in our organization. Okay, we improve conformance with legal requirements. Okay, we want to show that we are following the legal requirements regarding safety and health. Okay, improve employees' attitude towards health and safety. Okay, so we as an employer, we need to show a good example to our employees. Okay, so as an employer, if we have a if we want to focus more on safety and health as an employees, they also need to follow. Okay, so continually improve our OSH performance. So from day to day, from project to project, we can improve our OSH performance lah. Right, the core elements of developing the occupational safety and health in the construction project or even in the organization is the four core elements. Okay, the first one is planning. Okay, here in the planning, we can adapt. Just now we are talking about HIREC. Okay, so kita boleh integrate the HIREC punya approach during the planning of occupational safety and health management system. Okay, and then implementation and operation. Okay, so here we are. After we have planned our safety and health management system, then we need to find way on how we can implement, how we can operate that policy that has been developed. Okay, so we need to have a proper structure. We need to clear who are going to be responsible on that policy, on that safety and health aspect and so on. Okay, so maybe here we can create awareness, and we can provide training, okay, to create competency among our employees to emphasize more on safety and health aspect. And then another element is checking and corrective action. So bila kita dah implement, we are going to identify maybe there is some weaknesses in our policy, some loopholes that we need to improve. Okay, so from there, okay, we can improve. Okay, so before, because when we implement, of course, we need to have a proper record. Okay, so we have a proper record. Kita akan report pada top management. Okay, what are the incident happen? So from there, we can improve. Right. So from there, we'll bring to you to the last core of developing a safety and health management system in our organization or in our construction project is by doing the reviewing process lah. Okay, so we are going to review our safety and health management system. Okay, where we need to improve and etc. Okay, the principles of developing the professional safety and health management system is what we call it as a PDCA. Okay, so first is plan. Okay, this is some sort like the core just now lah. Okay, okay, we plan. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, we are talking about integrating the idea of IRAC tadi. Okay, we need to have set a policy regarding safety and health aspect, and then we need to do. Okay, maksudnya we need to implement. Okay, so kat sini again, we can create the implementation and operation punya core element tadi. Okay, and then we need to check. Okay, when we implement again, of course it's not going to be perfect. Okay, so we need to check where we can improve. Okay, so we need to assess the weaknesses of our safety and health policy or safety and health management system that has been developed before, and then act. Maksudnya we are going to review. Okay, maybe for the next project we could improve. Okay, we could reduce the accident, or maybe we could target for zero accident for our project and so on. Okay, so that's occupational safety and health. The principles will relate to the core ni tadi lah. Okay, so for Malaysian standard, okay, among the just now when we're talking about occupational health and safety management system is more on international standard tadi, alright? Yang this one, APDCA ni tadi is more on international standard punya guideline on how you can develop safety and health management in your organization. Okay, but Malaysia have their own Malaysian standard regarding safety and health. Okay, which is Malaysian standard 1722. Okay, so more or less is quite the same. Okay, cuma kita berbeza sikit. Okay, the as you can see in this diagram, okay, they start with the policy. Okay, so you have a set. You have to develop your policy regarding safety and health. For example, like policy of your construction project is zero accident. Katakan. Alright. So next, they need to organize. Okay, so they need to appoint a responsible person to in charge the policy to make sure the policy will be implemented properly and so on. Okay, then planning and implementation dia mergekan sekali. Kalau tadi macam POSAS tadi dia pisahkan. Okay, tapi untuk Malaysian standard, they integrate these two. Okay, they have to implement planning, and then after that they implement. After that they evaluate. Okay, and then last one is improvement, a shape of improvement lah. Yeah, they get feedback from employees, maybe PPE kurang dan sebagainya, so they can improve for the next project or for the next projects lah. Okay, if we are talking about Malaysian construction project. Okay, this one is more on Malaysian standard regarding how you can develop a proper safety and health management system in your organization or even in your construction project lah. Right, the last part we are talking about, we are going to talk about government initiative. Okay, some of the government initiative related to safety and health. Okay. So firstly, first government initiative adalah government introduce with the collaboration with the Ministry of Human Resources and DOSH, they developed or introduced Occupational Safety and Health Master Plan, okay, 2016 to 2020. Okay, in general, okay, not again, not mainly focusing on construction industry. Okay, they focus in general, overall, in our country. Okay, so it means that this Occupational Safety and Health Master Plan could be used for every sector or every industry in our country. Okay, so in this Occupational Safety and Health Master Plan, they give emphasis on the responsibility and commitment between employees and workers. Okay, so this two entities are very important when we talk about safety and health. Okay, employees and also workers or employees. Okay, right. Respect the right of workers to OSH. Okay, so as an employer, you need to make sure that your workers must be properly protected against accidents. Okay, maybe for example that you need to make sure that your workers are being provided with sufficient PPE and etc. Okay, involvement of workers in OSH activities. Okay, OSH knowledge and skill enhancement. Okay, so that's among the ingredient of this master plan, okay, developed by DOSH and also Ministry of Human Resources. Okay, beside that, another effort by the government is the introduction of SASIP, okay, Construction Industry Standard. Initiative taken by CIDB, okay, to introduce SASIP. Okay, so this is more the objective of SASIP. Okay, again, more or less related to safety and health. Okay, so basically, CIDB has developed the SASIP Safety and Health Assessment System in construction in 2008. Okay, 2008 lagi kita CIDB dah develop. But this SASIP has been revised in 2018. Okay, dia dah revised 2018. So by having this SASIP, we can measure your safety and health aspect of your construction project. So means that at the end of the day, dia akan keluarkan markah. CIDB akan keluarkan markah. Out of 100, berapa you dapat? 70% ke, 80% ke? Okay, of course, I think for the time being, dia tak ada lagi ranking tu. Okay, maksudnya nak dapat berapa untuk make sure you dapat penterapan dari CIDB sebagainya. That kind of thing. Or even this sashi, I'm not sure, I think it's not being made compulsory yet. Belum wajib lagi. Okay, dia ada. Cuma penggunaan dia masih belum tahap memuaskan lah. Alright. So there are how they can measure your safety and health aspect from your construction project by focusing on these three components. Okay, document check. Maksudnya kat sini pentingnya you punya policy, you ada, you clear, you tampal you punya policy maybe dekat you punya site office dan sebagainya. Okay, they are going to carry out site and workplace inspection and they are going to conduct interview with the employees. Okay, so from there they akan dapat markah dia lah. I'm not sure the portion of marks. If I'm not mistaken, 20-40-40. If I'm not mistaken lah, you need to double check. 20% kat document check. Workplace 40%, employees interview 40% lah. If I'm not mistaken lah, you need to double check on that. So when you can use SASIP in your construction project, when your work progress has achieved 25% and above. 25% until 75%. Okay, masa tu lah you boleh contact CIDB. CIDB akan hantar representative and then dia akan measure your safety and health aspect. Okay, selepas projek you capai 25% work progress. Okay, sampailah 75%. Lebih 75% dah dah tak boleh dah. Tak boleh guna SASIP. Okay. Right, another effort made by the government to focus on safety and health is the introduction of CITP, okay, Construction Industry Transformation Program, okay, so 2016 to 2020. Okay, for information, this is the second version of CITP, okay, developed by CIDB with the Ministry of Work, okay, Malaysia, JKR. Okay, so this is the second version. The first version is 2011 to 2015. Okay, dia nak habis dah 2020. I think later this year they are going to announce another version of CITP for the next 5 years. Okay, what is the objective of CITP? The objective is to transform the construction industry. okay, to be more professional, and also they want to increase the capabilities of the local construction players to be able to compete with the global players. Okay, that's the main objective of this CITP. Okay, we want to transform our construction industry to be more professional, and we want our construction players to be able to compete with the global companies. Okay, so there are four strategic thrusts under CITP. Okay, dia punya asas dia ada empat. Okay, which are quality, safety and professionalism, environmental sustainability, productivity and internationalization. Okay, this is the four components of CITP. Okay, even you can see this website. Okay, as you can see, the first ingredient, they include safety. Okay, that's how serious the government to emphasize on the element of safety in the construction industry. Okay, so this is the website of CITP. Even they have e-book. Okay, dalam ada e-book. Okay, empat area tadi. First area, dia ada their own KPIs. Okay, apa focus area dia. This one, environmental sustainability. So, that's the thing lah. Okay, under CITP. Later nanti kita akan detail. Okay, apa yang isu under, related to safety under CITP? Okay, yang ditekankan. So under CITP, CIDB has identified two major issues that need to be improved in the aspect of safety in the construction industry. Okay, first, we are talking about poor condition on work site. Okay, first we are talking about number of accident. Okay, this is the first issue which I have touched at the beginning of the lecture. Okay, as you can see, we are the highest industries that have fatality rate. Okay, dah berapa tahun dah. Okay, we are the highest. Second issue is about the poor condition of the work site. Second issue is about public perception of the industry. Okay, and limited awareness of initiative to improve the image of the industry. Okay, again, also I have touched at the beginning of the lecture regarding the 3D. Okay, so actually these two issues are related. Okay, with the workplace, worksite term, poor condition, as you can see, especially the workers' amenities. Okay, the main things that has been touched under this CITP is the workers' amenities. Okay, tempat duduk kerja, rumah kongsi. Okay, so as you're aware, the condition of workers' amenities, especially for foreigners, are very terrible and horror lah. Okay, especially kalau you, as of course, you sendiri boleh tengok condition of the workers' amenities, especially for foreigners. Okay, so daripada situ boleh contribute pada safety aspect of the construction industry as well. Okay. So the good thing about CITP is that it's not emphasizing on the issues, okay, yang berkaitan dengan issues on workers' amenities, issues on perception on the image of the construction industry, about 3D dan sebagainya. Okay, under CITP also they include suggestion on how to solve the issues. Okay. Okay, how to solve the issues? Firstly, improve level of commissioner safety and health at construction site. Okay, again, we are talking about training program, okay, construction specific safety training, okay, and then we can promote the usage of SASIC. Okay, again, we have SASIC just now, so kita boleh maybe later in the future, perhaps the government or the CIDB will make it compulsory for every construction project to use SASIC in their construction project. Okay. So in terms of workers' amenities, okay, more stringent requirement on the occupational safety and health will be introduced. Okay, maybe a development of code of practice. Okay, so actually there is, if I'm not mistaken, under Act berapa eh? Kita tengok sini. Okay. Act 1990. Alright. Actually, within our construction site, sepatutnya tak boleh ada workers amenities. Alright. But that has been normally practiced in our construction project. Okay, so sepatutnya berdasarkan undang-undang ni, kita tak boleh ada workers amenities within our construction site. Okay, so sepatutnya kita kena put our workers on a proper accommodation. Okay, so as you can see in this news, okay, so as an employer, they will find starting from September 1, okay, on yeah, new human resource minister, M. Saravanan, tadi pula sigaret. Okay, so you'll be fined 5,000, okay, kalau you tak tak provide a proper workers amenities for your workers, especially foreigners. Okay, so this is one of the effort lah, okay, to enhance safety aspect in within our construction site. Ya.
Kejap, apa tu
artikel ke apa? Tak tahu lagi, kejap lagi. Cepatlah. Alright, sorry. Okay, so that's one of the effort lah. Kita nak introduce, kita nak enhance our working environment. So we don't want any workers amenity within our construction site anymore. Okay, so I think dekat projek Putrajaya dah implement lah. Cuma I think projek sekarang other areas need to implement this idea lah. So in order to avoid from being fined by CDB. Okay, and the last one, this one under DOSH. Yang ini baru dibangunkan 2017. Okay, ini as I mentioned earlier lah, act yang kita ada tadi OSHA is more general. Tapi DOSH develop guideline specifically for construction industry. Okay, so as I show you just now lah. Okay, so guideline ni, right? Building and construction engineering work. So that the DOSH has give a guideline on how you can develop a proper occupational safety and health in construction industry. Okay, so dari yang the latest 2019, ni baru lagi lah. Yeah, ni guideline 2017. Alright, so that's one of the effort taken by DOSH to give a better understanding or idea for the construction players to develop their own safety and health in their construction project. Okay, not only based on OSHA, which is general, tapi dia ada specific punya guideline. Okay, dari DOSH lah. Alright, so for the conclusion, we know that progress is priority. Of course, as a contractor, we want to progress. We don't want any interruption for our construction project, because once accident happen, you have to stop work. Okay, so kita tak nak tu. That's why you need to make sure that safety will become mandatory for your construction project. Sebab kalau berlaku anything, it will interrupt your progress. So always remember, it is too late if you want to learn from our own mistake lah. Okay, so even though sometimes it's good to learn from your mistake, but in this case, especially kalau melibatkan safety aspect, accident happen, melibatkan kematian, it's too late lah to learn from your mistake. Okay, so that's all for today's topic. If any questions, you may ask. Maybe boleh open mic ataupun maybe boleh type Olan kat sini. Any question? Anyone? Ni semua ni saya pernah mengajar ke? Ada yang saya tak pernah mengajar lagi tak? Mashriq ni saya cam dah ajar. Azlina ni saya dah ajar. Yang lain ni saya pernah ajar ke? Tak pernah ajar?
Tak.
You, Zuhairi, full time, part time?
Saya full time.
Part two lah maksudnya sekarang?
Tak, saya part one tapi part time.
Oh, part one tapi part time, okay. Oh, yelah, subjek ni part one, part time ambil, betul lah. Lepas tu lah ramai muka saya tak family ni. Ada siapa full time?
Saya full time, sir.
Saya full time dah jumpa dalam 8.3 kan?
Last budgeting.
Okay, full time dah jumpa dalam 8.3. Part time je lah yang tak jumpa lagi.
Yang full time ni ada 9 orang waktu.
9 orang dia full time?
Yes. So, semua lebih, memang ambil 8.3 lah.
Oh, yang 8.3 lah. So, patutlah ramai saya tak kenal. Macam?
Doktor, kalau boleh saya nak tanya.
Ya.
Kita tengok tadi macam agensi kerajaan ni macam Dawson, DOSH, CIDB pun, even JKR pun adalah dia punya guideline untuk OSHA ni.
Okay.
In terms of apa ni? Penguatkuasaan tu. Saya rasa selama saya ada dalam bekerja dalam bidang apa ni? Construction ni. Ini tu macam ada tak ada je enforcement ni.
Itulah saya, saya sebenarnya benda ni memang diakui lah. Okay, bukan dalam bidang safety je. Okay, banyak area sebenarnya. In general lah. Okay, kita banyak benda government kita introduce which is good. Okay, idea dia yang bagus. Tapi when comes to implementation, fail. Sebab apa fail? Sebab kita tak betul-betul enforce, kita tak betul-betul monitor. Itu masalah kita. Okay, itu memang even saya tahu macam even macam construction project. Patutnya setiap projek kena ada seorang safety officer. Okay, tapi in reality seorang tu cover sampai 5 projek. Betul tak? Siapa yang kerja site ni? Ramai part time ni. Ha, tak ada jawab ke? Yang part time. Betul.
Ha.
So again, benda ni is very difficult to find solution. Okay, benda ni when comes to implementation memang kita fail sangat-sangat. Okay, sebab kita tak betul-betul enforce benda tu. Sukar untuk saya apa ni, macam mana agak nak memberi jawapan yang kenapa boleh jadi macam tu. Okay, sebab benda ni lebih melibatkan birokrasi dan sebagainya lah, benda-benda macam tu lah. Okay, so perhaps new generation nanti akan ubah benda ni lah, perhaps lah. Okay, masa kita-kita ni dah lambat lah. Banyak benda, okay, contoh macam dulu zaman, contoh lain lah, okay, macam GST dulu. Okay, zaman Datuk Seri Najib bila kita implement GST. Okay, GST actually is a good tax system. Diakui sebenarnya, it's a good tax system. Tapi kenapa dia gagal kat Malaysia? Sebab kita gagal implement dia dari segi bentuk implementation dia, masih orang masih tak clear lagi dan sebagainya, benda-benda macam tu lah. Okay. Itu salah satu contoh lah. IDS contohnya. Okay. Kita dah ada keliling government, kena every government project kena gunakan 70% IDS. Okay, sini ada yang kerja government agency?
Ya.
Nasib PTD kan? So saya tanya you, every government project yang sepatutnya bernilai 10 juta ke atas kena guna 70% IDS. Guna ke semua tu?
Tak.
Tak semua?
Ya. Yeah. Sebab yang kalau untuk IBS ni dia ada arahan dalaman pula. Memang arahan yang tu ada arahan dalaman pula. Macam kalau kat tempat saya dulu only 1% project dan perlu guna IBS. 1% daripada apa projek yang diluluskan, bilangan yang diluluskan.
So, tapi keliling JKR
tu juga.
Tu tak IC juga. itulah masalah dia. Tak tahulah, benda when comes to implementation memang kita agak kacau sikit lah. Okay, bila bab memperkenalkan polisi, memperkenalkan transformation program apa memang bagus. Memang A. Tapi bila bab when comes to implementation, kat situlah kita fail. Macam tu yang kena tengok balik lah. Okay. Anyone, siapa lagi boleh nak?
Doktor nak tanya.
Saya tunggu soalan daripada awak. Memang selalu awak tanya.
yang pasal yang implement ke tak implement tu. So dengan adanya SESIC ni dia tak boleh bagi kita macam impact ke kepada benda tu. Sebab dia kan macam SESIC ni dia buat documentation check, safety documentation. So SESIC ni tak dapat ke macam implement kita kurangkan apa-apa
accident. Okay. Macam saya cakap tadi lah, SASIC ni is a good idea being introduced by CIDB. Okay, cuma for the time being, dia tak wajib lagi.
Oh, okay.
And saya takut bila wajib nanti, tak semua orang guna.
Oh,
macam tu. Itulah masalah dia.
Okay.
Dia memang sekarang ni SASIC tu bagus sebab kita boleh measure kita punya safety aspect for our construction project. But for the time being, it's not being compulsory. CIDB belum wajibkan. Okay, maybe in the future dia akan wajibkan. Tapi saya takut bila wajib, tak semua orang guna. Itu salah satu isu yang kita kena tengok lah. Okay, so bila orang wajib, kena make sure orang ikut lah. Tapi sekarang kita boleh tengok macam safety officer sendiri, walaupun kita dah wajibkan, memang kita lantik safety officer tapi sepatutnya satu site satu. Okay, ini satu seorang sampai lima site. Itu yang kita tak nak tu. Lebih tentulah. Dari segi monetary mechanism kita kena strong lah. Okay, especially from CIDB punya site lah.
Excuse me, sir.
Oh, yeah.
Cakap pasal SASIC tu, right? Is a standard which is eliminate OSHA or safety policy in our site.
Okay.
So adakah ada satu standard yang akan jadi satu standardized yang kita boleh apply sama kepada semua bentuk project, which is kita tahu each of the project dalam construction ni is very different. So they have one standard yang boleh apply to the all, yang kita boleh evaluate kita punya sistem safety policy sendiri.
Okay, kalau kita nak ada standardized, as I mentioned pada peringkat awal lecture tadi, okay, construction site ni dia berbeza-beza. Kalau kita nak ada satu standardized guideline yang orang, bukan guideline lah, satu standardized policy yang semua site boleh pakai, it's very difficult sebab tak semua site sama sebab kita berhadapan dengan cara kerja yang berbeza dan sebagainya. Okay, pekerja pun berbeza dan sebagainya. So apa yang kita boleh buat, kita which has been done by DOSH. Okay, kita ada guideline. Okay, macam tadi saya tunjuk tadi. Okay, guideline yang semua orang boleh refer. As a construction player, we can refer to that guideline. Macam mana nak develop kita punya safety and health policy in our construction project. Okay, itu that the best thing we can do lah. Yang kalau kita nak buat satu standardized yang semua orang boleh guna, it's very difficult lah sebab kita punya culture, kita punya nature of construction industry ni berbeza-beza. Construction project kita berbeza-beza. So apa yang DOSH boleh buat, dia keluarkan satu guideline, semua orang boleh refer kat situ. So daripada situ kita boleh gunakan guideline tu untuk develop kita punya policy berdasarkan apa projek yang kita buat, cara kerja kita dan sebagainya. That the best thing yang kita boleh buat. Okay? Boleh? Siapa tadi?
Mami? Boleh.
Mami?
Kalau macam tu, which is that SASIC tu is the examination for our safety policy, betul?
Betul.
So, is that SASIC boleh apply or it can be macam boleh adjustable to the one of kind of project? Sebab saya tak pernah tahu, tak pernah encounter this kind of SASIC.
Okay. You kerja ke apa?
Saya kerja.
Bekerja pun tak tahu SASIC ada kan? SASIC ni is a standard how to assess your safety aspect. Okay, tu SASIC lah, dia punya assessment kat line, cara macam mana nak calculate. Okay, sebenarnya kalau you buka website CIDB, I think you boleh download SASIC ni. Okay, boleh dapatkan code objective tu, daripada situ you boleh study apa requirement SASIC ni untuk dapat you score tinggi. Okay, apa dokumen dia nak. Okay, daripada situ you boleh develop you punya own policy untuk you punya projek. Okay, kalau you in terms of document check lah tadi, tapi in terms of employee punya interview tadi, you kena make sure lah apa yang tanggungjawab you sebagai majikan, apa you perlu bagi pada employee atau workers, you kena sediakan lah. Okay, so daripada SASIC tu maybe kita boleh tengok lah apa dokumen yang diperlukan dan sebagainya untuk kita dapat skor yang tinggi. Okay, so bila skor yang tinggi maksudnya safety side kita, safety dia tinggi lah. Okay, dia beri penekanan yang tinggi lah.
Okay. Boleh? Okay, faham. Terima kasih.
Okay, sama. Lain?
Doktor, saya ada pertanyaan sikit. Doktor, saya Fazli. Tadi doktor cakap more to polisi-polisi ni kan macam tak banyak. Polisi tu bagus tapi enforcement tak jalan. In term of macam, let's say lah, macam saya dengan kawan-kawan yang macam kerja ni kan, apa yang boleh kita contribute untuk, yelah, nak harapkan orang tak boleh, tapi mungkin kita yang tak, kalau tak boleh banyak pun mungkin sikit-sikit yang doktor rasa boleh contribute
yang okay
dalam kita lah, macam US ke, architect ke, engineer ke, dalam bidang masing-masing lah.
Dalam bidang masing-masing, okay. Okay, in terms of contribution you as a whatever profession you ada, as engineer dan sebagainya, siapa Fazli tadi? Siapa QS?
QS, ya.
Berapa lama dah?
19 tahun.
19 tahun, okay. Konsultan lah?
Banyak sekarang konsultan lah. Sebelum dari kontraktor, orang yang kena kerja.
Sekarang eh?
Konsultan lah.
Konsultan lah.
Ini okay. Yang terakhir 12 tahun je lah.
Okay. Alright, so in terms of apa-apa polisi yang kita nak pakai nanti, tak kisahlah safety, nanti kita akan belajar pasal quality, kita akan belajar pasal waste. Whatever it is, they need to start with the top management lah. Okay, so kalau you ada pangkat dalam you punya organisation, okay, so kalau you boleh main peranan dari segi situ, baguslah. Okay, sebab benda ni akan start daripada top management. Sebab you, kalau you orang bawah makan gaji, tak banyak mana you boleh pakai, you boleh contribute lah. Sebab kan nak minta lebih-lebih kan, takut bos kat apa pula kan sebagainya. Tapi maybe in terms of as an employee, maybe you boleh ask, kalau bos you tak ada inisiatif nak fokus on safety dan sebagainya, maybe you as an employee, you boleh tanya bos you, boleh request bos you untuk pergi any relevant training program. Benda-benda macam tu je lah yang you boleh mempengaruhi sedikit lah dalam memainkan peranan, dalam nak emphasize on safety aspect dalam topik kita ini lah. Okay, sebab benda ni dia kena start dari top management lah. Okay, sebab kadang kalau kita tengok in reality, in construction project, even PPE pun tak complete. Betul? Apa kerja site?
Betul-betul.
Even PPE pun tak komplit.
Even though kalau dalam contract pun spell out pun, kata tak ada je. Nak claim.
So, benda ni dia dah jadi macam uh, nak kata bukan darah daging, macam mana dia jadi common. Okay, so benda bila dia jadi common is very very difficult to change lah. Okay, so benda dah melibatkan mindset dan sebagainya. That's why saya cakap benda-benda melibatkan implementation. Okay, kita mengharapkan new generation lah. Okay, so sebab macam kita ni tak banyak yang kita boleh buat. Okay, sebab kita dah expose benda ni dah lama, macam K. Fazli tadi dah 19 tahun lah. Kita dah expose benda. So bila kita nak berubah tu, it's quite difficult lah. Okay, so hopefully new generation will play their role lah untuk kita lebih untuk lebih professional lah dalam melaksanakan tanggungjawab dan sebagainya. Ya, apa yang the best thing, just kita boleh request lah. Okay, kita maybe macam contoh PPE tak cukup ke, kita boleh request top management untuk sediakan. Okay, so kita as a employee, walaupun employer kita maybe tak emphasize on safety, tapi kita fokus on diri kita as pekerja, kita concern pasal safety kita sebagai pekerja, maybe kita boleh request kepada boss kita apa requirement yang tak cukup on site. Okay, in terms of PPE, maybe nak pergi training dan sebagainya, that kind of thing. That's the thing, the only thing yang saya boleh fikirkan yang boleh buat lah so far lah. Okay, untuk mengubah polisi, you kena jadi top management. Okay, baru kita boleh influence others to change lah. Okay, harap membantu Cik Fazli.
Okay, boleh tuan saya.
Right. Lain? Nur Ain Syahira ni macam student CM ya, bukan? Okay, ada apa-apa lagi? Kalau tak ada, kita boleh stop our session today. Alright. I have recorded this session. Nanti saya akan share the link lah untuk you tengok balik. Alright. Ada certain lecturer maybe tak suka share recorded, tapi siapalah saya share untuk you tengok balik dan sebagainya lah. Don't forget to tick your attendance in your future dekat online class tu tadi. Alright, jangan lupa untuk attendant guys tu, sebab semua attendant will go through that lah, new feature. Saya tak pakai lain punya mechanism untuk ambil attendant. Saya akan ambil pakai new feature saja. So you have to tick that. Alright. So kalau tak ada, we can end up the class tonight. Okay, so thank you for your time and commitment. I will see you again next week on the next topic on quality management system. Okay, once the notes ready, I will let Nasrik know lah. As a class, right? Okay, once saya dah upload the IU features, saya akan beritahu Nasrik lah. Okay, so that's all. Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you, sir.
Salam. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Alright. Thank you, Doctor.
Okay.
Thank you, Doctor.
Alright.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you,
Doctor.
Sama. Assalamualaikum.
Thank you, Doctor.
Welcome.